Shelly Glashow was there in Paris. And I had a lot of conversations with him. He was a student of Schwinger's, and partly under Schwinger's influence, he suggested models of the weak interaction in which the Yang-Mills theory was applied somehow to the intermediate boson, the positive and negative intermediate bosons, the photon, and one other particle, which would be a neutral intermediate boson. How that was to be reconciled with the strangeness changing rules was not so clear. But it was a very interesting idea otherwise, and I formulated it, I think, a little better than he did, although it was his idea. And when I returned from Europe and Africa in the fall of 60, I gave a report on his idea to the Rochester Conference, which was, I believe, in Rochester. And I described it as a Yang-Mills theory based on the usual group, SU2 or whatever it's called, and a singlet, which we would call U1. So it was an SU2 times U1 theory. And I just described exactly how it would work. But Shelley had included some wrong stuff. He had said that this type of theory was renormalizable with brute force mass. And of course, that wasn't true, as Salam and Kumar had shown.
But he'd already done SU2 cross U1 by that Rochester meeting.
Oh, before that, even.
Yes, yes.
Even. He had written a dissertation, perhaps, right. Anyway, a long paper, including it, and including the mass, the symmetry breaking, claiming it was renormalizable, which it wasn't. But otherwise, it was clever, and it was essentially correct.
Because Schwinger had done SU2, right, prior to that. And because he was looking for real unification, as distinct from...
Yeah, but that didn't work, of course.
No, it didn't work. No, absolutely.
That didn't work. Also, he tried to deform it into a scalar and tensor theory somehow, because at that time, most people thought the weak interaction was scalar and tensor. That didn't work either. But anyway, Shelley and I talked a lot, and we talked also about a Yang-Mills theory for the strong interaction and what the charges could be and whether these charges would then be the same as the ones that would give supermultiplets for classifying the hadrons beyond isotopic spin. And if so, what would that system be? Well, I worked out what it would have to be. To generalize, the idea was to generalize Yang's and Mills' work. What algebraic system could replace isotopic spin? Well, I wrote down the rules for Yang-Mills theory and that would permit a generalized Yang-Mills theory, and I found what the rules were. I had charges that I called F, and the commutator of Fi with Fj had to be able to write in a suitable representation as little I, the square root of minus 1, times little f ijk times capital F k summed over k, where little f ijk had to be, there had to be a way of doing it so that little f ijk was totally antisymmetric. And the Fi's were Hermitian. Well, that's certainly true of isotopic spin, where little f ijk is eijk, the totally antisymmetric tensor with indices running from 1 to 3. But what was the generalization of this?